renowned food writer, book author, and researcher Micky Fenix sits as the president of the Food Writers Association of the Philippines, which manages the Doreen Gamboa Fernandez Food Writing Award. I've asked her to pick and read one of her favorite winning entries. Let's all listen.
Poor Boy, Merienda and the Time of Crisis by Viol A. de Guzman. Not all merienda are created equal. Some are for the haves, others for those who have barely enough, and still others for the have-nots. I've sampled all three. My mother was a GI, a genuine longa, who migrated to Manila when she was 16, the offspring of a prolific family tree with roots in Haro, Iloilo City, and branches as far away as Bacolod, Tabangkalan, and Bago cities in Negros Occidental. To her seven children, her most memorable culinary offering was authentic pancit molo, cooked only for major family celebrations, which usually lasted from lunch, punctuated by a mahjong session, and ending up on a high note with our special merienda. To cook pancit molo for 30 plus people, relatives by blood and by affection, my mother had to import her sister and mobilize her own daughters and daughters-in-law for the tedious task of rubbing hands of tiny savory meatballs. A native hen was simmered until tender, then shredded finely. Fresh shrimps were peeled, chopped, and sauteed in whole heads of garlic and onions, and these two combined went into the making of the broth. The meatballs were made from twice ground pork, enriched with egg yolks, flavored with soy sauce, the secret ingredient, tahore, salty fermented bean curd, minced garlic, scallion, chives, and black pepper. It took nimble fingers and much practice to encase the sweet balls in mola wrappers so that they look like a nun's winged pre-Vatican II headdress. The dressed meatballs had to be stunned for a few hours to make sure it did not fall apart when cooked in the rich broth.
Chef Khalil, what cookbook has had the most impact in your career?
There's lots of other cookbooks, so this was really difficult for me choosing. But when I was growing up, I always see this in the house. This one, The Good Cook.
As a young activist during the tumultuous martial law years, my merienda of choice was divisoria lugaw or rice porridge. It was cheap, tasty, hot, and fast. Just the thing for people who wanted to still the pangs of hunger while waiting their evening meal. Lugaw with isaw was filling enough to take the place of both merienda and dinner for people trying to live on minimum wage.
Cookbooks allow us to revel in the beauty of food, as well as develop our talents in the kitchen. But for this bunch of young chefs, it has done more than that. It has greatly changed their lives and forged the career that they are currently thriving in. Let's find out the noteworthy books in their libraries. Chef Khalil, what cookbook has had the most impact in your career?
There's lots of other cookbooks, so this was really difficult for me choosing. But when I was growing up, I always see this in the house. This one, The Good Cook.
It's a collection of cookbooks.
Yes, it's an old school. I think this is parang published parang 1980.
So anong influence niya in your life, in your career?
I think parang, di ba when you're a kid, and when you always see something, for example, you always see planes, you're mesmerized with planes. Tapos, syempre in your mind, parang, okay, I wanna be a pilot, like that. But for me, siguro, it was always there. There was no internet that time. There's no cable. So sometimes when you're bored in the afternoon, you get the book, and then you just browse on it.
So even as a young kid, you were very fascinated with food already?
Fascinated, but it wasn't my dream, really, to become a chef.
Interesting. So how did you become a chef?
I took HRIM in La Salle. When I was applying sa hotel, they always give my resume sa front of the house. But I wanted to work back of the house. I stopped na because it wasn't my passion eh. I worked for 11 days in a hotel in front of the house, and then I quit because it wasn't really for me. One day, my friend invited me to join the team, M Cafe, with a Chef South team. First day in the kitchen, well, I really enjoyed the pressure, the innovation in the kitchen.
So when you became a chef full-time, anong cookbook yung nag-influence?
Of course, you go back to the classics. No?
Do you think it's still advisable for people to go through cookbooks rather than just going to the net?
Yes. I'm thinking of the concept is, for example, pizza. Even if I'm holding a Japanese book, parang it gives me an idea what to do. Parang it's like my security. Kaya nga sabi ko, it's hard to choose with my books because baka magtampo yung iba.
Chef, can you show us the book again?
So that this we can one. Record. Tapos when you were young, of course, you start with pasta. Diba? And you think you're good na.
Okay. Thanks, Chef.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Angelo.
Hi, Carla.
Hi.
What cookbook has had the most impact in your career?
Okay. Well, I wouldn't say it's just a cookbook. Okay. It's actually the memoirs of Chef Jacques Pepin. Okay. So it's here. It's about his life. Basically, well, because the title is The Apprentice, My Life in the Kitchen. So it's basically how he started working in the kitchen, how he moved from France, how he got to New York and started working in kitchens there. This was at the time kasi na I was also studying in New York when I started reading this book. So parang syempre feel ko yung ano, yung him imbibing the American culture and then cooking French cuisine, because I was also enrolled in his school in French Culinary Institute. He was one of the deans in that school. His story made a very big impact because when he was making cuento about like the war and stuff like that, he reminded me so much of my lolo, how he helped his mom in the mom's restaurant and how it was like in shambles because of the war and how they built it up again. So it's kind of like, you know, the story of aristocrats. So so parang I could imagine then my lolo making cuento the same kinds of stories, ganyan.
So this book is peppered with recipes. It's not just a memoir.
It's not just a memoir. So every chapter, he has recipes there, and they're recipes that are close to his heart.
Parang, have you tried the recipes there?
Yes, I have. And as soon as I got back from New York, I cooked it for my lolo. It was the French onion soup. And you know, us naman, my family is like super in love with cheese, right? So definitely a lot of the Gruyere in there. And my lolo loved it. He actually requested me to cook it a few more times.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Hi, Chef Pat.
Hello.
What cookbook do you turn to for inspiration?
Oh, well, for me, ever since I started cooking, kasi I got this cookbook from Thomas Keller called The French Laundry. So I think it's his signature book.
French basics, yeah.
Yes. Parang all about his techniques in his restaurant. He made it very, easy to read for the reader.
And have you tried any of the recipes in that book?
Yeah, the recipes are very easy to read, very easy to understand because the ingredients, I guess, is very relatable naman. The techniques are very written very well. And, you know, I think he made sure talaga na people would really understand his mindset when he writes his recipe.
Do you have the book with you?
Yeah, it's here. Here.
So that's the copy that you've had since you were a kid?
Yeah, when I started, cooking about 11 years ago, I got this book. I always read this to get inspiration when I need to get some new technique or to refresh my kitchen technique.
So even if you're not cooking anything in French, you still turn to it for inspiration for to learn new techniques?
Oh yes.
Okay, thank you very much.
Sure, thank you.
Hi Carla, how are you?
Hi, Angela. How are you? I'm good, good.
Let's talk about cookbooks. What's your most favorite?
Well, the most favorite, the very first one, The Joy of Cooking. When I was about 12, 13 years old, my Lola lent it to me. When I went to culinary school, I bought myself a copy. So, this one. This was the newer version that they came out with after they updated it with all, they put all the, there's like fusion stuff in here now. When back in the day, it was mostly American recipes.
When did you get fascinated with food?
As a kid, always been fascinated with cooking and with food. My Lola's a really great cook. But she was more like cooking by ear. So she wasn't really into recipes or if I asked her to give me a recipe, she wouldn't even, she wrote it on a piece of paper, like what went in it, but not the measurements.
It's just a really thick book.
Yes.
Didn't it overwhelm you as a kid?
Yeah, it did actually. And then what I decided to do was to go look at the classics that I really liked. Like my favorite food as a kid was spaghetti bolognese. I didn't even know my first idea of spaghetti bolognese was Pancake House. So, or like Club Filipino spaghetti. And so when I started looking in the recipes and then I saw there's milk in this recipe, and I said, it doesn't taste milky in any place I go. So I said, maybe this is wrong. I said, maybe they don't know what they're doing. So, and then it turned out that our idea of bolognese is not exactly the classic bolognese with the milk. It's more like a meat sauce. It was overwhelming, but because I started with that and then I got into it. So I kept going through the book again and again. Of course, I haven't gone through the majority of it, but it's really kind of like influenced the way I cook. If there's something that I don't know and it's a classic, it's my go-to. I really just make sure that I go to The Joy of Cooking before I go into any other book.
And any dish you think of, it's most probably there.
Yes, exactly. It was kind of like interesting how they were able to stay classic, but also move with the times. So in the 90s, it was about the fusion and all that. So they were able to infuse it into this. And I think there's a newer edition, which has naman other cuisines, like there's Thai and there's so it's kind of like a good basic book to own, and it's whenever a friend gets married, I always give them a copy.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. Stay safe.
Hi, Chef. Tell me about your most favorite cookbook.
So mine is a little unconventional because I grew up looking at my mom's Chinese cookbooks. It's called an applied cooking book. So it's a very old Chinese cookbook.
And it's in Chinese.
It is in Chinese. There are some English words, of course. It's what we've been using since my mom started cooking. And it's what I've been using as well as a guide as I discover my love and my passion for cooking. It has all the basic things that, you know, you would find in Chinese restaurants here in the Philippines as well as abroad.
So is there any one dish that sticks out from that book?
Yeah, beggar's chicken. I'm not sure if you've had it before. So beggar's chicken is actually a marinated whole chicken that has been wrapped in lotus leaf, covered in clay, and then baked for hours.
Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, Angela. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Our second serving of suggested cookbooks from your favorite chefs is coming up after the break. What cookbook has been the most influence in your career?
Okay, in my career, I have two cookbooks that I still go back to.
JR's personal favorite is Poor Boy. It is named Poor Boy because it is something that poor boys and poor girls can afford. A small bowl costs only 10 pesos. It is cheap because its main and unique ingredient is cattle or carabao hide, sun's hair, and supplemented by lips, tongue, tail, and ears. The addition of cattle and carabao balls makes it a dish for the boys, believed by customers to be an aphrodisiac. a more accessible version of soup number 5. Poor boy is extremely versatile. It can be eaten as merienda, perhaps with a slice of bread, or as a viand, just add rice and it's dinner. Poor boy is unknown except in the Negros provinces and parts of the Mississippi. Its recipe cannot be found in cookbooks and will probably not win any prizes in cooking contests. What it is a witty, original, down-to-earth, determined, and courageous bit for life and survival, spiced with laughter and fun, even in the time of crisis.
Grabe, that got me so hungry.
I know, I want to taste it. This one, first prize in 2008. The subject was merienda. And the first prize, she also won another time in another contest.
Why is it one of your favorites?
Number one, it showed me something that was totally different from what I usually know. And then it gives a timeline, you know. We make do with what we have. And I think this is a beautiful piece that says you can throw away cowhide or make it into better wallets or whatever. But if you can cook it, why not? And so I feel that this person, and I want to go to Kabakaran to taste it. This person who cooks it is for me a chef.
Thank you so much. Thanks for your time.
Yes, no problem. See you.
Here's a continuation of the chef's favorite cookbooks. Hey, Chef Fran, what cookbook has had the most influence in your career?
Thai Food by David Thompson. Here's a digital copy.
This is the very first cookbook you had?
So I've had several Thai cookbooks before, but not one as detailed as this one.
The Thai book, you got it when you were already working for a Thai restaurant, right?
Yes, I ended up reading this parang torn up copy of that same book. Tapos later on, in a bookstore, I like reading kasi several books in bookstores also and checking which ones I'm gonna buy, or I found na yung pala yung it's the same book. So I ended up buying it and going through it over and over na when I got it already.
What do you like about this book in particular? Because there's so many Thai books, but what is it about this book that you like?
It's very detailed eh. Kasi being also a recipe developer and food consultant, I know kapag yung recipe is hindi siya masyadong na-test. So this guy, he's like, parang each recipe ng R&D niya maybe at minimum 5 times. So the way he inserts yung notes niya, and yung mga detailed processes that he learned also.
And then, of course, you learned from Thai cuisine about the balance of flavors. No? This is something that you can apply in different cuisines too.
Yes, actually, I realized from him, from that book, that Thai cuisine apparently is a fusion of different cuisines also, which influences of Chinese, Malay. Para siyang naging successful fusion of cuisines from way back.
Okay, thanks for your time and for sharing your favorite cookbook. See you around.
Thank you. Thanks, Angelo.
Hi, Chef Gon.
Hi, Angelo. How's it going?
Oh, good. How are you?
Doing well. Trying to get through this pandemic.
I know, right? Well, it's good to know that you're doing well. Okay, let's talk about cookbooks.
My favorite cookbook is this, White Heat by Marco Pierre White. I mean, this book really influenced me a lot. It's one of the first books that I actually fell in love with. It influenced a lot of my cooking, actually. Seeing a lot of the French dishes here inspired me to think if it was possible to actually do it to Filipino cuisine as well. Seeing how crazy it gets in the kitchen also lured me to being a cook.
Have you tried any of his recipes?
Yes, I have, and they're really sophisticated and crazy, but they're really good.
And it's very technical, right?
It is, but tasting it and doing it was actually really fun, and it was a great, great learning experience.
Was it intimidating to try any of his recipes?
When I started this out, I was just starting out cooking. So doing the first recipes was quite hard, actually. But over time, trying to do it over and over again, it was actually really good.
And up to now, you still turn to it for inspiration?
Actually, every time. Like every month, once I finish a new book, I would actually go back to this book and go back to everything that Marco Pierre White says. Because I really love his philosophy in cooking and how he treats his staff, how he cooks, and how he looks at food and cooking and everywhere, you know?
Thanks for sharing your favorite book.
Thank you as well.
Chef Tina, I have a question for you.
Yes.
What book do you turn to for inspiration?
Well, this is my book, my chosen book, The Escoffiers. It really means a lot to me. Also because it was given to me early on during the time when I still wasn't sure what to do with my life. So my head chef gave it to me and it was the last day of my second job. Parang we had to close down the restaurant and it was really a good time at that time because I was still figuring out really what my next step after that restaurant. So she noticed that I took pleasure breezing through this book in her office. And what made me really like it was that it was really a direct, parang the recipes in it were very direct. And parang, I guess at that time, I still wasn't so familiar with all the culinary terms. And I think this book really opened my mind to the possibilities. And at the same time, it's also a book that really made me realize how important the basics are.
Did you cook recipes of this book?
Yes, I think majority of people who in the industry probably didn't even realize that we really do, we took a lot of the recipes that we do now. All the basics practically came from this book. And what's funny is, you know, I'm not really the type that like reads a lot. I mean, spends a lot of time reading. I kind of like the picture-y kind of books. But if you look at it, it's really all literally like a Bible. So that's when I realized about, okay, I kind of really, really, really like what I'm doing right now. So, yeah.
It really is the Bible when you go to a culinary school?
Yes, it is. That's why. But fortunately, though, this version is a more updated version. It's friendlier. You can really read through it. And if you really like cooking, it really kind of defines a lot of the things that we do now easier. Yeah. So,
in essence, this book turned you into a chef.
Practically, yes. I would agree with that.
So we have to thank SKP for that.
Yeah.
Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you very much. Bye.
Hi, Chef Miko. Thanks for joining us today.
Hi.
Okay, I've got a question for you. What cookbook has the most influence in your career?
Okay, in my career, I have two cookbooks that I still go back to all the time. Okay. I have them here. One is what I used in school. Can I show you?
Yeah,
it's really old and ratty. It's what I used in school.
So when it's not commercially available. Available in your school?
This one, I think, only available for students. Yeah. And it's like it's super like old school. It's super ratty already. And it has like oil stains and stuff. But they have something that's commercially available. And this is the one.
It's heavy.
It's huge. Oh,
nice.
Yeah.
Okay.
So these things I still use until now because it goes back to technique. It's basic technique, like classic technique that I always go back to. And from there, I create new things. Like, let's say, for example, I have in Metronome, I have a squid dish that has a red wine sauce. But the red wine sauce already has squid ink and a little bit of soy sauce and all that. But the way the execution of the red wine sauce comes from a classic technique, which you can find in the books.
Mm.
So these are important for me because it allows me to kind of like root myself in technique and then step out from there.
It formed the very foundation of what you know.
Yes. And then my influences after.
Is there any one dish that sticks out for you from that cookbook?
You know, I think there are two. Poulet à la chasseur, they call it in the book. But now I have already put it in our takeaway menu. It's called Hunter's Chicken. That's one of my favorites because I think it's one of the first meat dishes that we did. And before that, we spent like maybe a week and a half on just vegetables and soups. That soup that sticks out until now is called it's like a vegetable soup. So it's just really for your knife skills. That was when I learned how to season properly. So things like that. So these are the things that kind of stick out because of the things that I learned, like basic things that I still hold true until now.
Thank you.
Bye.
Hi, Chef Eric.
Hello. How are you?
I'm good. What book has had the most influence in your career?
Yeah, a couple cookbooks, but the one that ever since I started cooking Mexican is probably this one, Heartwood.
So you got this book even before you started Chino?
Even before I started Chino. Yes.
What do you like about this book?
Oh, it's very rustic. And it's like, you know, all flavors that I never knew about. Like, you know, I was never taught Mexican food. You know, I just knew the flavors of Mexican food because I grew up in LA. So this like taught me, you know, what products they use in Tulum and in Mexico, what they could get, like fishes and sauces and all that stuff.
Have you tried a lot of the recipes in that book?
I actually have. There's a, you know, maybe, no, maybe 10, 12 things that I've tried. There's some stuff I can't try because I can't get here in Manila.
Any one dish that stands out?
There's one. There's this whole roasted...
And it's not just about tacos and quesadillas, right?
No, it's actually like more of like ceviche. So I'll just try to show you if you can't see it through here. It's roasted grouper, like the collar of the grouper.
Uh-huh.
And it's, you know, it's served with fruits and vegetables from Tulum. And it comes with this like cilantro crema sauce that I tried. And it's really good.
Is it something you offer in your restaurant?
I don't offer grouper collar, but I offer like a yellowtail collar.
Okay, thank you very much for your time. That's it.
Thank you, Angelo.
Wish you well.
You too. Take care.
And that completes our library. Stay tuned for more good eats. Okay, so what does it take to be a good food writer? Is it enough to be just a writer, or do you need to genuinely love to? We're joined today by two editors who know a lot about food writing. First is Jed Doble, a respected food writer and publishing professional in Indonesia. His brand, Foodies, publishes a bi-weekly digital newsletter featuring culinary stories from across the Asia Pacific. And then we have food blogger Spanky Enriquez, who spearheads the production of Let's Eat, the Philippine Star's monthly magazine featuring notable restaurants in the Philippines. Hi guys, thanks for joining us.
Hi, Angela.
Good day. Hi, Angela.
Okay, first off, how did you end up in this line of work? Let's start with Spanky.
I was one of the first bloggers back when blogging was still a thing. And this was back in 2006. I remember I took Anton Diaz, our awesome planet. He was one of the pioneers too, on a tour of Pampanga. It was a food trip. And we had sisig and all of these things. And on the way back, he kept on convincing me, Spanx, you're pretty glib and all of these things. Why don't you start writing? And I did. So that was 2006, almost 15 years ago. And that's how I started. And then eventually, Philippine Star got me.
How about you, Jed? How did Foodie start?
I started as a photographer. When I came to Jakarta, I started working for Time Out Jakarta, and I was hired as a photographer. I was always a photo hobbyist, but everyone knew that I loved to eat. So one day the food editor of the magazine was away, and the managing editor asked me, "Do you wanna write this article?" I said, "You know, I'm not a writer, you know. No, but you're Filipino, your English will be better than anyone else's. So can you please do it?" So back then the motivation was, you know, maybe a free meal, you know. Second month, the food writer left, and the managing editor said, "Do you want to take over?" I said, "Yes, because I'm enjoying the all the nice meals that, you know, you get invited to." But that's how it started. Foodies came a few years in 2016, and then because of COVID, we stopped printing, but we kept in touch with our readership through a newsletter, which still comes out every other Friday.
How about Let's Eat? Is it still on print?
We're doing digital now. There's two sides of the coin. One is we want to promote the restaurants, and we are, you know, via other channels. But at the same time, we have to respect the wishes of a lot of people, the sensitivities, that perhaps they may not want to go out yet, and it may be too rah-rah and too gung-ho at this point. Mm. Once people feel it's safe. Otherwise, we'll just be beating a dead horse, literally. Ah.
Okay, so what does it take to be a good food writer? Is it enough to be just a writer, or do you need to genuinely love it? Spanky.
I'm Kapampangan, so I grew up eating. My grandmother was one of the very first caterers in San Fernando, Pampanga. Growing up, whenever we'd visit her kitchen, she had a very large kitchen, which was one of those, I guess, one of those Jurassic industrial kitchens during the 1970s, no? But she started way back in the 1940s. And I remember this, that we would spend a lot of time there, you know, just sticking your finger in whatever was cooking in those giant pots. And all these smells, all these traditions of Kapampangan cooking, and as you both very well know, we're really known as perhaps the most decadent in terms of ingredients and cooking style. So that's how I grew up. And back here in Manila, my mom, so actually, Andrew, I'm considering going back into it now because everyone's doing home baking.
How about you, Jen?
I think you really have to be somebody who loves food. And then writing comes second.
No, food writing involves a certain kind of quality. You need to be observant. You need to tap all your senses, right? What are the other qualities that are required to be a good food writer?
I would want to say that you have to be able to describe food without the most common, which is taste. You know, that whole idea of describing food, not using the sense of taste, because when you're reading, when somebody's reading your article, I think you have to impart emotion. And I think taste is the least of all. You'll say something is salty. That's a flat description. But if you use other senses, like the sense of hearing and the sense of sight and, you know, the smell, must evoke. It's more evocative of a dish, I think. So you really have to grasp a good sense of how to describe things.
Spanks?
You have to read a lot. Back then, when I was in high school or college, I loved reading thrillers, Tom Clancy. But there were certain books that I came across in National Bookstore by Doreen Fernandez. So I remember distinctly Kim Lassa. Then Jean Gonzalez, Chef Jean, had Cocina Sulupeña. And Cloud had his food tour. And these were all published before Bourdain hit it big. And I was reading these books again and again. And I loved the writing. I loved how we're being able to describe food in so many ways, in a very sensitive way. And when Bourdain came along with Cook's Tour and Kitchen Confidential, and it's the thing that really convinced me that I really enjoy this. And when so you develop your own language of food writing, and you base it on your experience, and you are supposed to be influenced by all of these great writers, and you take a lot from them. But for me, the most important thing is you have to discover your own voice. And in our generation, Angela, our icon is Lori from Dessert Comes First, no?
Oh, and
I know, right? She's like the ultimate best writer. And then, of course, the late, great Clinton Palanca, likewise. Mm-hmm. So those are our role models. And you see what they do, right? And you try to emulate them the best possible way with your own voice.
Would you write critical reviews if a restaurant deserves it, or would you rather keep your mouth shut if you have nothing nice to say? What's your take on that? Would you write critical reviews if a restaurant deserves it, or would you rather keep your mouth shut if you have nothing nice to say? What's your take on that?
Me first?
Yeah. Go ahead.
Especially now, here's the situation in the Philippines. We're such a tight-knit group, and we've always refrained from saying it out publicly, out loud, because we very well know that a single critical review can ruin a business, and this business is predicated on a lifetime savings. That's why all of us here, starting when I was still a food blogger, we try to talk to the restaurateurs with a critical eye, but at the same time, very supportive eye. And since the pandemic started, we formed an organization, Angela, you're part of this, FrestoPH. And what happened was, we're now all supporting each other. There's no competition right now in the industry. What we're all trying to do is help each other survive. And just to illustrate a point, three of the best and largest, most popular steakhouse in the Philippines, Albert's, and as well as House of Wagyu and Wolfgang, are all working together, all very active in the group, along with Mamu, of course. So it's become one tight group. We have to ride out this crisis, and perhaps once things return back to the old normal, we can be competitors again, but in the same vein, we'd become friends. So I don't think we can ever become that critical, knowing the sensibilities we have as Filipinos.
I would have to agree. You know, I think, because in the magazine, I always say this even to the guys who write for me, I won't waste a page on a negative review, because the negative review will only create enmity between you and, you know, and like what Spanky said, a restaurant is built up by the chef and the restaurateur, and we don't want to ruin a career or a restaurant because of that. So I normally would speak to the chef or the people if there's something I see that I maybe didn't understand or didn't like. I'd want to be able to explain or impart my feedback, you know, before or not even getting to an article. I'll speak to the chef. Just recently, it was funny because there was a pop-up which opened a few days ago, and I rushed to come to the place because I was excited to go and eat out, you know. And one of the dishes was, to be honest, quite tasteless. Okay. So I was sitting there at my seat, and I was gonna say, will I use the word tasteless, or will I say, chef, it wasn't good, or, you know. And then when he came and asked me about it, I said, it came out. I said, chef, it was a bit tasteless. He said, just a minute, give me a minute. And then he went back to the kitchen and he tasted it. And he said, yeah, no, it is tasteless. You know, so I'm happy that I used the word tasteless. But, you know, I want to tell him. I don't want to tell anyone else.
Yeah.
You know, I'd rather tell him. And for a chef who wants to listen, thank you. But if he doesn't want to listen and thinks that that's up to him, at least I gave my honest feedback.
Okay, how does one build credibility as a food writer?
First, you have to be honest, right? Never write a fake review just to fluff up or support your friend. You either, what Jed said, either you don't write about it or you talk gently to the chef. But you have to build a certain amount of credibility. So in the Philippines, what we're used to is we don't write about the bad restaurants. We talk to them privately. But for the good restaurants, we praise them to high heavens for two reasons. One, before COVID hit, Angela, you know this, 2020 was supposed to be our golden year, our boom year, our best boom year ever for restaurants in the Philippines, ever. And it we've been peaking since 2016. And unfortunately, this happened. And to be supportive is not only in terms of giving a nice release or giving a good review, it's giving constructive criticism as well. And if you do that, and you establish some sort of a bond, friendship, and relationship with the chefs, with the restaurant operators, and from then you move on. And I wasn't in the industry. I was never in the industry for long, forever. But I just found myself into it. But I found a certain amount of unity with the industry over the few years. And once you help the restaurateurs and make them know that you're on their side, you want to help them succeed, sometimes being critical is actually a good thing. And that's how you build credibility.
I think to build your credibility, you have to know your chops also, you know? When I compare myself to a chef who's cooking at his restaurant, I would probably have eaten at more restaurants, other restaurants than him. So that's also how I want to build that whole idea that I've eaten my way around also. So I've established probably, I would say, as a baseline for, you know, good food probably, you know. So I also want to be honest every time I have a meal. And like what I said, I'll tell the chef or to the restaurateur or whoever who wants to listen, because giving accurate feedback is what I think they need when you're opening a new place. They need that to come from somebody they trust. Because sometimes it's understanding the dish. Maybe I don't get it, but in his head, he gets it. But they need accurate feedback. And I think being able to share this kind of feedback, you endear yourself to the people who run the kitchen. So.
Thanks very much, guys. Thanks for your time and sharing your knowledge.
Thank hey, Ange, thanks a lot. Hey, Jed, good to see you, man.
Nice to see
Hopefully
you.
We can fly to Jakarta again soon. And...
Or I'll come home soon, don't worry.
Right. Yeah, Angelo will take care of us when you come home.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thanks, Ange. Have a good day. Stay safe.
I hope you had your fill for today. This is Angelo Comstee. I'll see you next time.